Hey guys, it is GoldenEye DS, and in this episode of Xenosaga Episode 2, Jenseits von Good und Böse, we're finally going to destroy CaptainMatthews Debt. We're going to kill Orgulla in the process, and thankfully going to steal tons and tons of stuff from her. So this episode I thought was going to be quite short, until I realised the monumental task of actually stealing 21 awakenings from her. It's about 2 hours 20 minutes, so brace yourself. A lot of it's going to be sped up by about 4 times, which means this whole episode's post. So before we go in, the last time to check that you possibly can, that you've got everything you need. We've got Ice Coat is needed on Momo. You want Blade Coat, Sphere Coat. I think we'll go through them in a second anyway. But Blade Coat and Sphere Coat, possibly ST Resist 20, Combo Boost. Focus 1's a must. Same with Stock 1 and Boost 1 are great to have. Revert any Medica classed ethers, said Boost 1, break sensors and break arms. And of course, everyone needs Analyse and Psycho Pocket to pull off the awesome combination that is Pocket Rare. It's always guaranteed you to get the rare steal, so you need to do it. It just makes this fight actually not an utter ball ache. I mean, it's still a ball ache, but it's not as much of a ball ache as it possibly could be. If you had to do that all, manually, that would just be a nightmare. So anyway, let's go check what skills they've all got. Again, for some reason. There's a lot of information about what Orgulla is, and it goes into some really deep stuff just for a name, so we're just basically bullshitting for an hour to talk about stuff to do with her name and what she might represent, and how her character can exist in a world like this. So as you saw, we have the expansion pack, definitely worth putting on because it means you can put on more than one or two of these coats, which is going to help you when Orgulla starts throwing some serious ice shade right in your face. Rare plus 10 is not needed anymore because of our pocket rare combination, so don't even bother with it. Ignore when I previously said that I totally forgot about double ethers, because you're never told in the game. You're never ever told in the game about it. It just kind of happens. I think maybe right at the beginning, but it's not even mentioned. I don't feel like it was. I don't know. It probably was used right at the beginning, and everyone will tell me. In fact, I do remember it being used, being told right at the beginning that you can do ether stuff. Anyway, let's go to look at Shion. She has a swimsuit, sphere coat, blade coat, and ST resist 20. She won't be getting poison very much from some of Orgulla's attacks, and she'll also be great against two or three of her main sort of elements that she attacks with. Ice coat, vitamin 2, and swimsuit. You must equip swimsuits to everyone. This is regrettable because no one likes seeing Momo in a swimsuit. But the agility boost is what you need to. You need the agility boost. It just pushes you beyond what you can do. As you see, we've given Momo the ice coat and the swimsuit and evasion plus 2. The reason for this is we're going to use break sensors, and that reduces her dexterity and evasion, meaning the agility boost we get from here and the evasive boost means we evade a lot more attacks. The agility, as you can see, is quite a low stat. Boosting it is massive to you. And then decreasing her ability to hit you on top of that just means most of her attacks won't hit. And they don't land their mark, you're not getting damaged, which means you don't need to do as much healing, which means you can spend more time stealing from her and stocking and making sure you're all in the right place to be when you're ready to go. Now this fight is a huge long fight, and basically the idea of it is you're going to, in her regular form, her Iru form or normal form, you just want to steal an awakening from her. Then wait for her to just go into her mains form. When she's in a mains form, just wait, go back into her Iru form, then steal again. You want to get it to below 1000 HP before you start this, just so that you've only got like one whole stock to go, and then kill her. That way that you've only got a stock to go before she dies, meaning once you've got them all, you only have to do one attack, as opposed to the whole battle, which, as you can see, would be pretty horrific, especially because considering above 1000 HP, she throws out some pretty nasty attacks and heals quite a lot, whereas below 1000, that behavior seems not to exist. So anyway, see if you can recognize Orgulla's voice and just realize how an awful character she is.
Welcome to this holy confessional. Come in, you filth.
What?
There is nothing to fear. No matter what you do, there is no escape from this place. Now, confess your sins. I will listen to anything. Even from the mouths of foul beasts like you.
You damn bitch!
I see. You do not wish to admit your sins. You will leave me no choice but to rip you apart.
That was Margaret's voice from Persona 4, in case any of you recognized it, or 3, I guess she's in that too. Or is she in that? Is that Elizabeth? Anyway, this is Orgulla, and there is so much to talk about, and so much time to talk about it in. So we'll start with some basic battle stuff. We're doing this whole grinding thing because we want Captain Matthews' debt fund to be completely eradicated. So, she'll steal some boost count, she'll do some nasty stuff at the beginning, this is why you want her under 1000 HP. Shion's great because she hits with electricity most of the time, and KOS-MOS is great because she'll do that strike damage. So that's 1.5 and 1.35 amounts of damage. You want to hit her with a BC-BB combo, which basically means boosting Shion, stocking with KOS-MOS to be able to pull that off, and then boosting with Shion and then Momo to unleash all your stock. So right off the bat, you want to get her under 1000 HP before you do anything. And the best way to do that is just break sensors. Don't bother with any of this complex shit that I'm pulling off, just break her sensors. Once her sensors are broken, just keep on top of that so that she's able to hit you less, and then just stock. And keep yourself well healed, well above half HP, and then just wait until you're fully stocked and then unleash a huge combo on her, and that's that. When her eyes flash blue, it means she has 4 to 8 turns between turning into her mains form. She's in her normal form now, and when she's in her mains form, she'll have the same thing where her eyes will flash green, and she'll have 4 to 8 turns to turn back into her normal form. So the idea is you want to steal, you can steal from her right now if you want, but I waited until I was in the right place to do it, so that I was focusing on one thing at a time and not trying to do much more. Although you could save yourself maybe 4 or so minutes, because each cycle is about 4 minutes in length, so that's something you do want to think about while doing this. You could pull off a lot of special attacks, but I'd highly recommend just, I mean, using Shion and Momo for this and just getting her aired with KOS-MOS. Don't bother with it, lots of complex status inflictions or try to get H on her, it's just not worth it. Just give her break sensors and you'll be fine. Another thing to note with her is that in her normal form, which is now, she has the Awakening 2, which is what we want to steal, so make sure you steal that from her normal form when you're ready to go for the steals. She has a few other stuff in her other forms, but you don't need to worry about it too much. And you can see every time you do the Aether combo what steals she has, both rare and non-rare. She also can poison you using her regular attack now. You'll see she can also refresh her L statuses. She can recover a load of HP, but she doesn't do any of this below 1000 HP, which is why stealing from her there is better. She's in a pattern that is very defined, and you'll understand it to the point where you will basically predict or know what she's going to do and be able to recover very easily from everything she will throw at you. So the reason we're here is Captain Matthews' debt fund. As you can see, we've got 0 at the moment, 0 gold. We've got 0 awakenings. As soon as we steal 1 awakening, 2, that is worth 500,000 gold. So that means we need 20 to pay off Captain Matthews' debt, and we need 1 more for ourselves, and steal 1 more because just to fuck you to the game designers and everyone else for this. Although it's not their fault, they were probably told, you're on a budget, we've got to finish this game now. Guys, just drop everything and make it happen, which is sadly probably what happened with this game. So as you can see, airing her sometimes can be a bit difficult, but you just need that extra boost that I didn't use there. I don't know why I didn't. I think Momo was too near being killed, so I just kind of abandoned the whole run. So yeah, now let's get talking about Orgulla. And as soon as we hit the cycle, I'll start to explain more about how this cycle works, although I already have explained before we went into the battle, so you should be good to go. So basically, Orgulla is a cyborg. She works as a handmaiden or assassin of the Ormus Patriarch, Sergius the 17th, I think it is. Yes, the 17th. Sergius just reminds me of Compare the Meerkat adverts now, which is pretty bad. But he's the old space pope that we've seen flying around and doing a lot of old person talk while having a lot of white hair and being adorned in what would be very pope-like. Considering he works for Ormus, which is kind of like a religious sort of terrorist organization, sort of not. They're more accepted than extremist factions of today's world, but they are still there, and they are still very, they back a lot of things in the background. They're very secretive, and in a way, they're much worse than what we see now, because they own huge chunks of big corporates. They're part of huge conglomerates already, and they are, for all intents and purposes, well integrated into everything. The political system, the weapons industry, you know, they have their own army, as we saw with the PSS is coming up. So you don't really want to put stuff past Ormus. They're organized and, you know, they have a nice face, or at least the face is of Christianity. Whatever Christianity, the form that the Bible or Christianity has taken in these 2,000 years. Well, not technically, but that's a story for another day. This is the year 4,000, of course, so because time didn't pass linearly, as there is explanations for. It's not technically 2,000 years, but obviously the Bible, its translations, everything might have changed. So what we're essentially going on is she does believe in the story of the Christian New Testament and the Old Testament. So that's what her belief set is, which none of you asked because she's such a minor goddamn character. But here we are talking about why she believes in Jesus Christ, which is just ridiculous. But we need something to talk about, and there is a lot of stuff we can garner from her. So, she, as I said, she's an extremist Christian in the same way that, you know, being an extremist doesn't make you of any part anything. Okay, so here we see her switch of personality. Now, this is to do with the fact that she was used, she's a specialized cyborg, and she was used in UMN transfer experiments. As we can see, she's weak against fire and pierce, so Junior is pretty good to have right now. You can steal a skill upgrade E from her, those sell for a bit, but not really much. But they're still fun to steal. I should have really stolen them, because it would have been the icing on the cake. But I was too busy just doing stuff like break sensors to her. So the idea is that she was used in the UMN transfer experiments. Not many people survived these. In fact, the idea was that you put someone through the UMN and see what happens. Usually you open a gate, you gate into the UMN column, and you go through a tunnel, and you're also protected by a ship. Now those two factors enable you to survive that. Usually what happens is you go through the UMN tunnel essentially exists in what we call the imaginary number domain, which is where your wills exist. Because there's an idea of dualism in this game where your body and your mind are two separate things. Your mind exists as a will, essentially, or a soul, shall we say, in the imaginary number domain, and your body exists in the real number domain, your senses, your sensory stuff. But your body can't act on things in the will, in the imaginary number domain. They can't act upon your will, but your will can act upon your body, and other people's wills can act upon the real number domain. And even inanimate objects have imaginary number existences, which is unusual, but explains why the Gnosis are able to interact with certain objects that aren't real, that aren't necessarily, that don't have a soul, if you will, but may have some. It's a bit confusing, that whole aspect of it, but they do exist. So, with that in mind, this accident caused her to have what's called as DID, which is dissociative identity disorder. Most of you will be going, what's that? Why isn't she just called a split personality? But that's completely wrong. Any psychologist will have just a fit at you and froth at the mouth when you tell, oh, she's got split personality disorder. Basically, the idea is that split personality disorder, as previously known as multiple personality disorder, is a mental disorder, on the dissociative spectrum, characterized by the appearance of at least two distinct and relatively enduring identities or personalities, or personality states that alternately control a person's behavior. So essentially, it's a personality which comes out. They may not have any memories of the other personality, they don't tend to share memories, and they can exist as almost a separate, what you would see as a separate person within the same physical body. That's dumbing it down a lot, but essentially it's the idea that multiple personalities can exist within inside someone. And there's different levels of this, and, you know, I'm just going to be rambling shit if I keep talking about this. But, yeah, it's usually accompanied by memory impairment for important information, not explained by ordinary forgetfulness. And they're not accounted for by substance abuse and all the other stuff, including imaginative play in children. So basically, she has two personalities. Now, how could this be possible? Well, actually, it makes a lot of sense. As I said before, you need to go inside a ship if you're going to the UMN. As we saw when we've ever gated into somewhere, we've gone inside the UMN. And for us to do that, we need to have a shield. Even Shion had a shield when she went in that nice fancy craft that that, oh god, Kevin designed. No one's gone in on their own apart from one man who survived, and we haven't really talked much about him, but that was mentioned right at the beginning of the game. He survived that, so that was pretty crazy. But she survived this, being a cyborg, and what happened is she picked up another personality along the way. You see, wills exist in the imaginary number domain, and what happens is if her body and will went in to the imaginary number domain, it's possible she picked up another will on the way that attached itself to her will and then became part of or tied to her physical existence in her real number domain. Her real number domain body. Now this makes sense because a lot of people, in fact nearly everyone else who've gone through these UMN transfer experiments, have just come back empty shells. You put them through the UMN to get, because the idea is they want people to, not just ships to be able to move from one place to another, but people to really quickly move between two places to another. Think like beaming in Star Trek kind of thing, being able to move quickly between two places. But the problem with that is without any sort of shielding, your will is ripped from your physical existence in the real number domain, and you just come back as essentially a body that has no individuality. What makes you a human? Well, what makes you a human is usually, or what makes you alive, conscious. It's that idea of consciousness. What is consciousness? And that is what is ripped from you. Your body will still be able to exist. You're essentially in a brain-dead state. So most people who've been through these transfer experiments are brain-dead and essentially would be put down and killed afterwards because there is no part of them which made them an individual left. They just exist to breathe and then eventually will die because we don't know the exact details of that, but that is what we can garner from the idea of the will being ripped from their body because of going through the UMN unprotected. So that is a bit about her and her crazy double personality, which is the wrong way of saying her dissociative identity disorder. And actually, I had an interesting a lecture at university by the psychology department by a girl who suffers from DID, and she has a load of male personalities as part of her. One of them's a 7-year-old boy, and it was interesting her talking about how her boyfriend deals with that when she would change into this boy, essentially. He'd take her to the park, or him to the park, and play with him like you'd play with a 7-year-old boy, and it all seems very unusual, and for someone like me, who only has one personality that exists inside of me, it becomes very unusual to comprehend that, and I think that's why you think, that can't be real, that must be fake, but it was definitely, you'd have to be a bloody amazing actor to pull that off, and keep it up for almost seemingly no apparent reason. So now she's back to her normal form, we can steal from her. She's not quite under 1,000 HP yet. One or two more attacks and she will be, and then we'll be able to start our fun session. She'll use Quick, but don't let that bother you. Please don't let that bother you. Just continue as you are. So the idea is we will use an Analyse. The first turn she transforms back, instantly grab the Awakening. Just instantly grab that Awakening. Once the Awakening's been got, then you can worry about healing everyone, getting everyone to shape, stocking everyone ready for the final launch. And then when she's transferred, she's gonna probably switch before I'm able to steal from her this time, but you'll see soon that won't be a problem. She'll do a lot of things like this, like trying to increase the chance of poison, but I wouldn't let it worry you at this stage. So we've got to 665 HP. This is the best time to now start your strategy. So I was just going to give myself some boosts because we want to be able to make sure, we need to boost. You always need to make sure you've got enough boost, more than one boost to pull it off, and for some reason that boost didn't actually go through, which really narked me. I used a boost max, but I forgot that boost max just increases the maximum boost you can have, not actually gives you more boosts, which is really badly named. So as you see, we use Psycho Pocket, we boost now. You boost with Shion, then press triangle on Psycho Pocket. Pocket Rare comes up, and you go with it. And because everyone's got Analyze on Psycho Pocket, it just doesn't matter, you boost everyone. And we stole our first Awakening 2, and as you can see, 500,000 gold appears. So yeah, we're 1/20th of the way through Captain Matthews' Debt. How does that feel? We're probably a good, I don't know how long into the episode, so maybe that's something for you to think about, 15, 20 minutes. See, I'm just standing still because I'm just thinking about what's going on now and trying to take it easy because I've got to the right point in the battle. I mean, that's 20 minutes anyway of a boss battle. We've still got more to go. So, let's talk about her name. As you see, Focus 1 is proving great because everyone restores MP. That's fantastic. So she'll use Scattershot a lot as well. But with your evasion, a lot of it will miss, and that's what you're really hoping on, especially with her break sensors. Refresh L just gives her a chance to waste a turn, because you've got three turns anyway per one of her turns, so I wouldn't worry about it. It's well worth just keeping up. So yeah, this is basically the cycle you'll repeat forever now. It's very easy. Just break sensors, so steal, break sensors, wait. She transforms, break sensors, wait. She transforms, steal, and just keep yourself above half health. That's it. That's all there is to this. Just keep going and you'll be fine. Honestly, it's just tedious. It is just tedious. Honestly, I'd tell you to cheat. I'd really tell you to cheat, because it's clear that there was a lot of internal conflict with during sort of the final part of this game, or at least not internal, but from maybe the higher up with how much they had to get finished, and a lot was dropped. And I don't think it's fair to blame the developers as much as we'd like to, because at the end of the day, they're just developing code and doing their job. What am I trying to do? Am I trying to explain my own situation here as a developer? But no, this is often the way it can work, and when you're told to drop something, you just have to drop it. And that could have been the case with this game. It could have also been the case that someone made some really bad decisions. But we'll never know, and also I don't speak Japanese, and am unable to reach out to the people who would be able to tell me of such issues. But it's always interesting when you find out inside developer stories about games. I love it. It's really cool because it's like a big black box normally to you, but now you're starting to find out some of the decisions which made something which you're just playing now for fun. I think it's brilliant. I really do love that. So yeah, this is taking a long while, but we will speed up shortly. I'm just showing me establishing the cycle. Okay, so Orgulla. Now, Orgulla is Spanish for pride, although Orgulla is the feminine form of a glow. I'm probably going to pronounce that really wrong, but it's a masculine noun, and it's two versions, self-satisfaction, pride, or sort of satisfaction, pride, such as the student was full of pride when he was given a prize, and the city is the pride of our country. So it's like the satisfaction of something, or satisfaction of yourself, which makes sense. So a lot of people would say that she is Gnostic. Now, Gnostic is a funny word, because it's also part of the word, it's more of the word gnosis, and gnosis is part of Gnosticism. Now, if you're going to sit there and look at me going, what the holy crap is this? Well, it does have something to do with her. It makes a lot of sense, but right now, I'm just going to park that up for a second and talk about her two forms. Her normal form, Iru, there's no real evidence that Iru means anything other than what a few guides call it. Her normal form is her normal form. But her mains form, which I've spelt wrong, which I'm going to correct now, her mains form, basically mains is to do with a chthonic deities. I'm going to pronounce that wrong. Sometimes thought to represent souls of deceased loved ones. That is what mains mean. It is of Roman origin. But don't see how that makes any sense to Orgulla. It doesn't seem to, but that's just the way it goes. It might be that she is trying to repent for all the damage she's done in a previous life. Maybe she is the soul, a deceased soul of a loved one, because she's a cyborg, and maybe Mains is the deceased soul of a loved one, the extra will that has attached herself to her. But we're just guessing at this point, and quite frankly, making excuses up for the shoddy character development at this point, which is seems like what we've been doing for the last 30 goddamn minutes. So yeah, in a branch of psychology called the philosophy of mind, there's something called dualism, which is the idea that there's a difference between mind and matter. They're not identical. For example, that's where you believe that there's something more to humanity, to what makes us human and what makes us individual, than just our body. And Xenosaga openly admits this. In fact, this is pretty much part of its universal build-up. It is what it thinks, how the universe works in Xenosaga is essentially dualism, as said by the philosophy of mind. There is difference between mind and matter. The difference is between whether they exist or not in the imaginary realm, or whether they exist in the real number domain. The imaginary domain and the real number domain. And that really is also, in a way, what she exists. She exists a very basic form of dualism, because she has two personalities, ho 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 ho. But no, she exists a part of that because of the two personalities inside of her that she got by going through the UMN. She's almost proof that there is something more to the characters of the universe than what is seen between them. There is something more to the body and to consciousness than what we're aware of in what we see around us, the matter that we see around us. And that's interesting, because Orgulla actually, in the terms of the universe, enables us, and a few other characters as well, to say, well, actually, this manual, which tells us all about how the Xenosaga universe works, is backed up by in-game characters who have experienced things which could explain this or go so far for the characters in the universe to come up with this theory on their own. And that's what's interesting. And that's maybe where Orgulla... how can I be bullshitting that there's such a tiny, pathetic character basically justifies the entire basic setup of the Xenosaga universe? But here I am. Here I fucking am doing all of this. Isn't this ridiculous? So, anyway. In the philosophy of science, there's a thing between... Dualism usually means between the subject and observer, and the observer. And we kind of see that all the time because of Udu. Now, Udu observes, we've seen this, he observes people, he observes things that go on, he exists outside, yes, the second awakening. He observes outside of our ability to perceive. He actually observes from the upper domain, and we're in the lower domain. Now, what does that mean? Well, the lower domain consists of the imaginary number realm and the real number domain, and they're both what we experience, but he exists outside of that. And there is a great form of that duality in the philosophy of science right there, because there is an observer and a subject to a great degree. In fact, we're all subjects to Udu, who observes us. Now, there's also another form of dualism, which is what she exhibits. It's the theology, good versus evil. In terms of Gnostic dualism, or is basically someone who believes in that there are two, there is good and evil. Oh my gosh, sorry. Let's go back a second. In theology, dualism is good versus evil. Someone who believes that they're both independent and equal, sort of like Satan and God, in a way. But instead of more Satan and God, they're both... that's the best way of putting this. They're both equal and equally powerful, but independent, never the same. And if she's a believer in the Bible, then she probably is a believer in the dualist theory in theology. This is me having done a little bit of research, but not a lot, trying to fill out an episode. At the moment, I'm doing a pretty bad job because we're only 29 minutes in and we've got ages to go. But yeah, finally, she has a Gnostic belief. She believes Gnostically. Oh, this is such a hard thing to say. She has a Gnostic belief. The Gnostic belief is that divine souls are trapped in a physical material world. Often, these people will try and abstain from the pleasures of the body because they believe it is not something that they should concern themselves with. So, like the same way that you'd find people that don't eat meat or don't have sex, all that sort of stuff, they don't do because they think it's just the problems with the flesh. There's a number of better ways out there, essentially the lust of flesh, shall we say. The issue with the material world as a whole. And, she probably follows that. We've seen before that she's a pretty devout religious person. I mean, whether you can call her that. So she probably is in some way Gnostic. The idea with Gnosticism is through Gnosis, which is the name of the villain in this. What? Gnosis is basically knowledge, or Greek for knowledge. They can be freed, but Gnosis isn't something that you just learn or happens to you. Well, Gnosis is something that you learn through experience or you get taught. It is something that just happens to you. It is internal. It's by internal, intuitive means, which basically means that it's like an internal revelation. Something inside of you changes and you're... internally, and you're able to go, wow, I've got this knowledge. Now, we've seen this happen to, one of the early characters in Xenosaga 1. I can't remember his name now, it's evading me, but it's, not Andrew. It's one of the lieutenants, the one who turns into a Gnosis. He undergoes a change right at the end. There is nothing left for him, that he is not in control of his destiny, and he just, who he is and what he is just nothing. In a way, in the grand scheme of things. And that revelation turns him into a Gnosis. And people do turn into Gnosis. And it's that internal sort of knowledge that he suddenly gains is what leads him there. And that's kind of where we link back to the whole idea of Gnosticism. And to be Gnostic dualism, is basically the idea that the world contains two fundamental entities. Probably good, bad, god, the devil, kind of things like that. This is simplifying down at a massive level, I appreciate, because honestly, this is so far above my head. But there's a lot of this mentioned on the wiki, and if you go looking for Orgulla for more information, I thought I might cover this, because this all sort of responds to making her maybe seem a lot more fleshed out than we originally anticipated. Because at the end of the day, she's just a main character, she's just a crappy character that we used to farm with. Otherwise, she'd be a 30-minute battle that we'd, once we kill her, what happens then? Oh, she just fades away. She just fades away like a regular enemy. That's how bad it is. I mean, she's got the minor boss battle music in the background, but even so. So, what I'm kind of trying to come to now is, Xenosaga is well known for dropping religious references in all the time. A lot of people would say they don't really make any sense, but by looking at this, at least in terms of a very simplistic view that I hold, I've been able to understand at least part of how the game's religious references feature in. And with Orgulla, we was pretty start off pretty rough and thinking I'm just going to talk about her name. When I actually started to look at it, there's a lot going on, and we can talk about a lot to do with her. We can talk about the way that dissociative identity disorder has a place in the Xenosaga universe as an explained phenomena in both science, well, in science and in philosophy. We can also talk about how this person's belief, or this person's DID, is part of what proves the universe exists in that way, which is unusual, to say the least. And it also might be bullshit. So yeah, that's really my take on Orgulla as a boss. At this point, we're just grinding her for awakenings, and we're a quarter of the way through. As you can see, this takes quite a while, but each block is about 4 minutes now, which is great, and you get yourself down to that, and you will fly through. Just have something else to do. While I was playing this, I was distracted constantly by Meg playing The Witcher, which obviously is pretty... It's a distracting game. You always... Whenever I see it on, all I see is just beautiful graphics, and Geralt being just this sexy man-beast going around with a gravelly voice and just killing things. And then you see, obviously, all the characters that... It's just distracting game. It's just quite nice to look at, and that was what was distracting me from, quite frankly, this boring area, this grey... It is literally grey everywhere. It was steel. It's a steel monstrosity. It's like something... It's like a concrete monstrosity, something we'd put up in the early 50s, is it? Or am I just chatting nonsense? The 80s. Was that the concrete time? The concrete time of the UK, anyway. You'll be driving through the UK, and you'll just be looking and go, oh, that's a nice brick building. Oh, that's a nice modern glass building. What the fuck were they thinking? Why is there a concrete mass? When I went to Bangor, you had a lot of this. Their new building, Pontia, which I was never really there for, in the year that I started there, they said, Pontia's going to be ready. And then the second year out there, they were like, Pontia's going to be ready this year. And then the third year, Pontia's going to be ready this year. And then my girlfriend was in the second year, Meg. I was in the third year. And by the time she was in her third year, they were still saying it's going to be ready, and it was still just a huge mound of land. And then 2 years after that, we've gone back and Pontio exists, and it's a nice building, other than they've literally spent a good couple of million pounds on some piece of art which is supposed to demonstrate the Welsh mining families, but actually just looks like a giant piece of snot. But I really don't understand that kind of art, because it's the end of the day, if I do something, it's just an expression of how my mind works, but isn't necessarily something we need to applaud or celebrate. Just, I guess, that individuality exists and people think things that are not the same as everyone else or can interpret things differently. But I don't think that should be celebrated when people spend large money on basically a ginormous blob of snot, of which it is. But yeah, the point of me talking about Bangor was that you've got some nice brick buildings, you've got an old building, which actually isn't that old, which looks like Hogwarts, and then you've got this huge concrete monstrosity, which basically is the chemistry building, and it looks so out of place, and you can tell when it was built, and it's awful, but it still is there, and right next to it is a huge tower block as well, which is what my original primary school looked, no, secondary school looks like, because I technically had a middle school, if you want. It was like 2 years, year 7 and year 8, where we went to, that was on a different site to the year 9s, which meant you didn't have loads of shits when you went into year 9, because all the shits were contained in a small area in a shit building. But that was also where I developed most of my anxiety. So, you know, you take some, you leave. It's a good idea when you're not in that environment. When you're in that environment, it's pretty shit. Although I say that, we're not talking about, you know, in a city school where people get stabbed, we're just talking about it where people bully you and the same sort of things as most schools, really. It's, you know, It just happens. So yeah, that's I don't know why I started talking about concrete. No, yeah, that's the way this game feels at the moment. So we've got 7 awakenings. We've got, oh my gosh, 14 more to go. And I'm seriously rapidly running out of things to say. In fact, quite frankly, I don't want to be talking any more this evening. This is where I'm going to drop off commentary for now, and we'll resume commentary at another point in the future. Why? Because voicing an hour episode is far too much for me at the moment. My voice is a little bit strenuous, and it's 8:30, and I've got to be going to sleep in an hour and a half, and I don't want to spend my whole day talking and bullshitting about Gnosticism. To the point of which, Gnosticism, to which the point I don't understand. But anyway, one last thing I want to say before I do switch to later commentary is that Gnosticism is, the Gnosis, do have a big part in this game. And without spoiling anything, the idea of Gnosticism does make sense in terms of the Gnosis. And when we all find out what the Gnosis are, it becomes pretty revolutionary. I mean, we know someone has turned into a Gnosis, that has been said, but past that we don't really know. We don't know what they are, and me mentioning a lot about the universe's background and history and the way that it fits into maybe our understanding of universes and science probably hasn't helped or maybe has given away what they are. But I think when we all find out in episode 3, we'll be pretty happy. And I can't wait to get there. Honestly, this Ormus stronghold has dragged on for far too long, and I feel like this has drained my enthusiasm, but I can feel it getting stronger, knowing that I'm being out of this soon, and that I'll be able to delete about... Seriously, this part, is in its raw format, is about 100 gigabytes of video file. It is just over the top. It is just ridiculous. So anyway, I'll probably wait to the end of the cycle, just because it makes it easier for me to sync this up later on. So yeah, her eyes about to flash blue again. As you can see, it's very rinse and repeat. Also, the frame rate bet looks really nice now. It's 6 frames a second, and speeding through this, you'll be so depressed when it goes back to the regular 30 frame a second version of the game. I have looked at hacks that make you play it in 60 frames a second, but it is not easy. And a lot of games, when you start messing with how many frames they output, you realize that's how they made a lot of their counters. They counted on how many frames they outputted on. So you'll start to affect a lot of things. Like Kingdom Hearts has a similar thing. It's some animation speed up, timers speed up because they count on frames. This is definitely the case with a lot of older games, because there were lots of workarounds to make them run effectively on the systems they were on. And it's really interesting hearing people talk about the sort of things they had to do. It was really interesting reading an article about how Neo Geo Fast Racing, I think it's called, on the Wii U works. They've done so much custom stuff, like old arcade games, to get it to run the most performance out of the Wii U, and because of it, it looks stunning. There are areas you can see where the sacrifices they've made, but in terms of rewriting a lot of things, it is a stunning game. 60 frames a second, motion blur is amazing, it just looks wonderful. I'd really recommend you pick it up if you're a big fan of racing games like that. So anyway, we're about to get the next awakening. That should be the awakening number 9, and we'll see you guys later. Once I've just come back from sorting my throat out. There we go, we're nearly halfway through, guys. We're nearly halfway through. And I am now back from like a week break. In that time, I've been to probably like 2 Comic-Cons. It's absolutely ridiculous. But no, I decided I wouldn't have this nice seamless transition like you'd expect from some top pro YouTuber, simply because it's important for you to know that I didn't record this whole episode in one, because the last episode took it out of me while I was doing all that research and trying to get across all the interesting information about Orgulla and what or how she exists in the world she is in, and how it explains many things about the Xenosaga universe, or at least how certain things are possible. Like, a lot of what we've seen with Sakura and the mental disconnect that she experiences, that doesn't necessarily prove the existence of Udu, other than Udu has influence upon people. But this one here, Orgulla, does start to explain how certain mental conditions could be affected by things in the imaginary number domain, in the imaginary number realm. There's two, it's the upper domain and the lower domain. The lower domain is made up of the imaginary number realm and the real number realm, it's real number domain, and then it's upper domain. No, they're both domains, I think. Just to make it extra confusing, they are both domains. And there's lots of other cool stuff. In fact, when I finish Xenosaga 3, I'll probably do a little chat, which basically covers the perfect guide. the translation that's been done, and we'll just talk about how ask the questions that the perfect guide does, and I'll explain them with what the guide says, and then any extra information that I can find, and that way we'll be able to, you'll have a series on YouTube which at least goes some way to explain a lot of the things. Now I know in Xenosaga 2 there is some sort of database functionality, or at least there has been from I think one of the guides or something, and the reason why I didn't heavily tie it to this series like I did with the first series is basically because this series doesn't have as many words in it that you're like, what is that? What does that mean? And most of it is self-explanatory as we go on, which is good. It's good to know. Whereas Xenosaga 1 throws you in the deep end and starts talking about things like DME addiction, and you're like, what the hell is that? And then you realize it's just a big hulky guy literally eating eating human-made human's flesh, which is always a fun thing to talk about. In fact, Xenosaga has helped me out great a lot of times in my life, because it was the reason that I got 10 out of 10, which is a shit score, in an artificial intelligence and intelligent agent module assessment, which basically I always talk to, because that's the noise you make when you're in his lectures after you're waking up and yawning, because, dear God, was it dull. I don't think I can understand what the guy wanted from artificial intelligence, but one of them was to determine whether something was artificial or not. No, sorry, one of them was determined through a series of questions whether or not something was correct, I think it was. So the idea was you had two different groups, like you were determining whether this animal was a dog or a cat through a load of different things. It wasn't quite 20 questions or whatever it's called. I can't really remember it. It was programming something called NetLogo, which is basically another version of a programming language called Logo, and it's an IDE developer. It's pretty clunky, but a lot of people program some artificial intelligence stuff, or at least that's what we were using. Anyway, getting back to it, I was talking about what the difference is between a cyborg, a human, and a realian. And he comes over and he starts talking about, asking me what do these mean, and I was like, well, the idea is that a realians are human-made humans. They have... They're basically humans designed by humans to be as human as possible. So they're not really artificial intelligence because, well, they are in some ways because we do adapt a lot of how they think and how they act to what we want because soldiers and stuff. But we also don't really, we haven't created their intelligence from ground up. It's something that exists as part of every human, but we've just modified and adapted it, piggybacking off whatever, which is what programmers do all the time, because rewriting everything from scratch is just basically asking to get yourself slapped in the face. And that's all interesting and quite cool, but then it gets onto the idea of, well, the artificial intelligence is KOS-MOS. Like, KOS-MOS is running an AI. And it's interesting to see how far we've got with AIs at the moment, I guess. But anyway, I started talking about this and how realians were cool, and how there's androids, and how in the series the android is so far behind the realians, and cyborgs exist as well, but obviously they're just humans with robotic parts, and how, you know, there was a difference between all of them, and we went, it was a pretty crap piece of work, but because of me basically blagging that, and because I pretty much bum off Xenosaga's universe in general, it got me some decent marks, which was great. I think he was quite surprised by the fact that there was that kind of depth maybe in a game that's as obscure as this, but that is probably goes, it almost seems like that is the reason why this game is remained obscure, is because there is a lot of depth, and if you want to get into it, it's not something that lends itself easily to just being immersed in. You have to in some way immerse yourself, I think is the best way of putting it. Which is what I did when I originally bought Xenosaga 2. I think I probably already talked about this, but when I originally bought Xenosaga 2, the box in the UK is different to the US box and the Japanese box, I think. It's definitely different to the Japanese box. The cover is basically a lot of characters, and it shows it's quite crowded, whereas the UK cover is very... It was very clean. It was just the bike that KOS-MOS rode when she saved us from almost certain death through testaments and all those almost ships. I think it was almost ships. And it was just KOS-MOS on the front by that bike. And the back of it was... It was all very clean and white and very unusual, and it was a double disc thing, and that attracted me instantly, because how often do you see games now that have two discs in them and were built like that, and folded out and had all this cool artwork and were like a special edition DVD case. So I picked it up thinking, this looks interesting and is worth a try for, I think it was $12.99. So I got there to try and buy the damn thing. And at this point, I'm like 16. Got a beard, you know, deep voice. And what happened was that they looked at it because it was a 12. Now we have different ratings here in the UK. We have BBFC, which is the British Board of Film Classifiers or classification, or along those lines. We also have PEGI, which is parental explicit guideline shit. I don't know. No one likes PEGI, but PEGI until recently wasn't the law, but now it is. So if a game is like 18, is PEGI, that's it. But you used to have if a game had sort of a video on it, or enough cutscenes to classify as a video on it, then it would be rated by the BBFC. And certain games were rated by the BBFC if they were deemed to be explicit enough that they needed a forced rating on. So, for example, if you think of what game, Grand Theft Auto. The original Grand Theft Auto, I don't know what rating it had, but if you think about along those lines, it needed a rating so that younger players would be denied it, because PEGI wasn't legal. You could buy a game that was above your rating. It was a guidance system. This game was a 12. And I can't remember why it was a 12, because really there's nothing on it. I think it was more a 12 because of the disc that was on. The disc contained the cutscenes from Xenosaga 1. And let's be honest, there's pretty much a rape scene with Momo. Let's be honest, that's what it was. And even watching that and not being prepared for it was pretty bizarre, and I think that was probably what put the rating up and made it so I had to be ID checked, which I didn't have, so my dad had to buy it. And if they hadn't let my dad buy it for me, then that would. But it was stupid. Like, I was 16 or I was 15, and I didn't have my ID at that point. You don't have any form of ID at that point other than your passport. So there's nothing else you can do if someone asks you for that. And to be honest, I think he might have been saving it for himself. And that was why he was being a bit of a dick about it. But, you know, I mean, when you have a beard, you're quite obviously over 12. I mean, that's almost insulting. Although 12-year-old me did have some form of facial hair, I think. So, anyway, without that, I wouldn't have got into it. And it still took a long while. There was a lot of barriers to getting into it in the UK, as any person knows. It's a US game. They only released Xenosaga 2 here. Xenosaga 1 and 3 never appeared here, and 1 only appeared here in a cutscene form. So it's very difficult to get hold of, and of course, until recently, PlayStation emulation has gone. I say recently, we're talking about 5 years ago. PlayStation emulation became as good as it is, and PS2 emulation is fantastic. It's enough for me to play this LP on it and upscale it so that it looks a lot cleaner and clearer for you, which is fantastic, because to me that was really the benefit of doing it on an emulator as opposed to the actual console. And obviously, if you wanted to mod the consoles, it was all out there, but there's a difference between half soft modding and half hard modding, and it was a pain, and getting your hands on all the things to soft mod it, or even hard mod it, were quite difficult when I started to look at this. So it was all, everything was against me, and it took me a long while to get me into it until I downloaded Xenosaga 1. And the reason why I didn't buy the games to import them is because at this point I'm still either a student, or I've not got any money, I'm not earning anything because I didn't have a part-time job or anything, so I had nothing to buy it with. And the problem with even that then is that the only people that would ever get, if I bought a copy of Xenosaga now, there would be no way that I could get that money to the publishers. It's just going to a shop, or the person who's selling it to me, who's previously bought it. I guess you could say, well, technically, downloading a copy is generating it, and that revenue could have gone to them, but let's just cut the bullshit right there. When it's a game like this, and you want to get hold of it, the easiest way is just to download it and running it on an emulator. But I downloaded it and put it on my PS2 running on the original hardware, because Xenosaga 1 still has a lot of emulation problems. So yeah, it was really a big thing, and it took me a couple of years to get into it. But there's one memory of Xenosaga 3 that shines through. Near the end of the first disc, I got back from basically I think the Knutsford Fair circus thing, and I got back from basically being the seventh wheel, which is always fun when there are three couples and you're the odd one out. Two of them were an unofficial couple, but they acted like it, so we counted that as one of the wheels. I don't get why it's a wheel. Two people don't make a wheel, It just doesn't make any sense, but yeah, your third wheel, I guess you're the odd one out, because wheels tend to come in twos, but you could be a Robin Reliant. So, the whole thing is just, it was just crap, and I got back from it thinking, fuck this. Sat down on a hard floor with my back against the bed, and just played Xenosaga. And it was about 6-7 when I got back. And then the next time I looked at the clock, it was 3 in the morning. And I was like, the fuck? Like, 7 hours just vanished, and I didn't realize it. Because the story in that game gets so engrossing in the final part of Xenosaga 3. They nail the cutscenes a lot better than in this game, as you can probably tell, because when was the last time we had a cutscene, guys? Well, let's talk about a cutscene with a major character where something big happens, not talking about when this character steps onto the stage. It's a long time ago, and even worse than that. So, to me, Xenosaga has always been something which is kind of drawn me in, but also pushed me away, because it's something that's very difficult to actually use. And then you've got bigger things against you. Like Xenosaga 1 was a dual-layered disc, and not many PS2 games were dual-layered. It was 8 gigs on one disc. Now, obviously, all DVDs are dual-layered, because to fit most of the stuff on. But, most PS2 games at the time were just single-layered. They had no need to be dual-layered. So, running that was also a pain. Most, if you burned your own copy, that was unsuccessful. Sometimes your console had trouble reading dual layers. There's just a whole range of problems. So, running it off a hard drive on your PS2 is usually the better way of doing it, but even then, there were problems with switching between the layers. Let's just put it this way. There were things stacked against you, and then when you finally got around to it, I found the US version of Xenosaga 2 was the best one. There was just, like, the problem with the European release is all these text boxes you're seeing are just, they don't change size. When you're in Momo's domain, the best Momo's subconscious domain in the summer, the best place to think about that, there was a lot of text boxes that said, envious is staring at you, or something like that. I can't remember what exactly they said, and they were fitted to what the words said. No, not in this. They were just huge. And I'm assuming it's because, I actually don't know. They needn't localize it. If you're gonna want to release a game cheaply, don't localize it between it coming out in the America and the European region. You just have to, well, I guess the idea is it's gotta be translated into different languages. But that's why I'd like to see more games that at least come to the US, come to the UK at least, because they don't need to be released to the entire of the European region. Most of the European region probably speaks decent enough English to understand it, and especially if you're at a profit margin like with Xenosaga, just do it, because as long as it's in English and already exists in English, it's easier for us to get hands on, and then it, you know, whatever. So yeah, it's always been one of those games that I've really gotten into. It took me a long time to sort of love anything about Xenosaga 2, to be honest, even though it was the game that drew me into the franchise. I still dislike large elements about this game, but the battle system is something which is, it took me until this playthrough to really understand and appreciate for what it is, especially after coming straight from Xenosaga 1's battle system, which is just slow. I mean, it's just the slowest thing ever. I don't understand why those animations had to last that long. But oh dear, did they have to last long. At least with this one, is they're quick, they're to the point, and in Xenosaga 3, they become very quick. You press a button and the attack happens, and it's all like, did I just punch someone in the face? So that's all pretty great, and it's nice to have. I use that phrase now. People at work use it all the time. It's just one of those things where you pick up on other people, or the phrases in the workplace. So anyway, we're on our 18th awakening, which is great. Super happy about that, because I cannot be fucked. It's taking so long. But if you look, we're 9/10 of the way through, which is a nice feeling. And you might have noticed that these sort of cycles sped up. Take about 4 minutes, which is great, because unsped up, I don't know if that's 16 minutes then. No, I think they're like a minute. Let me just have a look. It's about 35, about 37, so 2 minutes. So this video has been sped up by 4. So yeah, at about 8 minutes. Eight minutes then, shall we say, per turn. So really, you're looking at 8 times 20, which I'm not going to try and work out, even though that's obvious. It's 160. So that's like that's nearly 3 hours, and I did this in 2020. So that there is definitely something wrong with that maths right there. But yeah, so just as you say, this we're literally about to steal the last one, and once we've done, we've hit the maximum amount of money. Captain Matthew's debt has been paid off. Just think about that. We have completed a side quest that would have taken us anywhere between 6 to 18 hours to complete, depending on if you do this at the beginning or the end of the game. And here we go. She changed back into her normal form. No, she's in a mains form. Yeah, she's still in a mains form. That's just disappointing. I thought she'd changed into her mains form, but her Iru normal form, but she hadn't. But we are closely approaching the time. When I was doing this bit, I was just almost completely dehydrated. If it wasn't for... It was just really hot in the room, and it wasn't even in the summer when I recorded this, I don't think. Here we go. She quicks herself, and we boost, pull off a pocket rare, and steal that last awakening, meaning we now have the full amount. We now have 20 awakenings, which we can sell for massive rewards. So, make sure you steal another one, because you'll need one to use on yourself, obviously, unless you want to get 19 and then sell everything else to make money, but just don't do it. It takes a lot of other crappy items to get close to the amount that one awakening gets. Just don't do it. And especially since you're, 2 hours in, there is no point. So I stole one more, and then I forgot how many... I literally had a piece of paper in which I was crossing off the number each time, and then writing how many times I got left, just so I knew what was going on, because otherwise I'd lose count, and I lost count, which is fantastic. So I just kept going on. Double Mendic is always good, but you see, I try to keep people's health quite high, because otherwise you'll be in for a shock. When she kills you 2 hours into a battle, and that's when you think, you know what, I'll just run an action replay code to give me 99 of every item, and then I won't have a problem, because you'll just sell 20 awakening ones and you'll be fine. But she's the only person that we can do this on, thank goodness for this oversight. It's not a hard oversight when you think about it. I kind of understand how it came about. It's all interesting anyway, coding. I mean, I guess they just told it to switch. See, we've gone into normal video again, but it's still at a slideshow, even though it's normal speed, which I don't understand why. I must be catching up with itself. Oh, the hard drive's on its way out, which is probably likely what it is. So anyway, we're doing this because the mains restraints program. I guess that's that virus that I think gets deployed or something. We could bullshit about that side of it all day, but we all know what it really is. It's just Seller putting something to restrain her. She's got like a lightsaber as well, but there are no official like images of her other than what's in the guide, and people have photoshopped it out, but it's not the best. So I didn't really want to use it for the thumbnail. Anyway, we're about to Psycho Pocket again, pull off a Psycho Rare, and this is the 21st Awakening, which is all you need. It's all you need. Don't worry about anything more. You've now got an Awakening 2 for yourself. So we've hit 21 now. What else have we got to do in this battle? Nothing, just finish her off. She was at 600 health about that, if you remember. And it doesn't take very much to finish her off from here on out, so just do it. She's basically the same now. You've 420 HP. But I thought I'd just steal a Skill Upgrade E, which I really should have been doing this whole battle. Because even that's quite a valuable thing to do, because you could just boost your skill points through the roof. It's a shame that every time she switches, you don't get points for each time she's in the form. And I think you get more points for defeating her on a certain form, but I haven't tested it out. And it does say each form gives you a certain points in the guide. But I'm not sure if that means at the end of the battle you kill both of them or just on the one you kill. So sadly, it's displaying a slideshow, so I'm unable to tell you what's going on at this point, even though it's slowed down. But we're just going to break sensors. I was just keeping everything ticking over, to be honest. I think it's one of those times where I got to the end, and it was just... I didn't really believe it, so I just want to steal a second one. See, she's got that turn cancel thing. It's just annoying. But the amount of time she point blank shoots Momo in the head, and Momo's just stood there, and somehow Momo's evaded it. All thanks to the agility that your swimsuits give you. And I don't understand how. I mean, I guess. Let's be. Instead of wearing armor, but they don't wear armor. There's no way your normal clothes. You're more. There's no way that the clothes that Shion wears, she is more agile in her swimsuit. There is no way. The same goes for Momo and for KOS-MOS. She's a fucking android. Let's be honest. She's a fucking android. Her swimsuit is literally something you have to put on top of her and then skin on her. Whereas before, she doesn't have a frame that exists as skin. It is just a frame that's not very heavy and not meant for battle. Clearly, it weighs less. But let's just get over the fact that they're going to give you points and give you positives for basically objectifying women in this game and try and move past that. It is hard, but the agility boosts is what you want here, and I would love to be able to extract them in the same way that you can extract in Xenosaga 1. It's just a shame. I mean, why give Momo a swimsuit? I mean, come on, guys. Come on. She's like four. I think she's like 11 years old mentally and the body of like a 12-year-old. Not that that makes a difference, really, because it's to do with the body, and she'll always be 12 years old, which is just, I mean, there you go. There is nothing more to it. So if you're asking what I'm doing and why I haven't ended this episode already, I don't know. At this point, I was beyond delirious, and I just wanted to make sure I'd got 22. So we're just waiting for her to change again, and just boosting our boost gauge at this point. So we're ready to go for the final assault, which you will not recover from, which is basically what we've wanted to do since we've started this battle. I don't know why I'm stocking everyone up. I think we're just waiting for her to change. Yeah, Mane's awakens. Unless you want to... I think the guide does specify you kill her on mains because you get more points for it. Maybe? It's been a long time since I've looked at this. I've actually seen some cosplay of Orgulla. Which is really fucking surprising, considering how tiny Xenosaga is, and then again how tiny she is. It really is surprising. But I have seen more than one Orgulla cosplay. I mean, how? But there we go. If I was to go as anyone, it would probably be Albedo or Testament. One of the Testaments. Because I like their, I do like their outfits. It looks quite cool. And also mean you'd go around and you'd just basically be able to defy physics and stuff, and it's not like some girl who basically decided to go as Mystique. Most people go for, you know, a morph suit. This woman went full hog. I say woman. I'm going to say girl. She decided that the only thing she really needed to wear was a blue thong and just call it nipple tape. A very small amount of nipple tape. And then paint herself blue all over and just hang free, because there's no such thing as showing too much off in a Comic-Con. Oh dear. It was truly awful. Meg pointed it out to me and I was like, what is going on here? It's actually the Liverpool Comic Con was some of the most sort of scandally things, and you're looking around and, you know, they're all like 15, 16 year olds. I'm like, this shouldn't be something we're trying to get them towards doing. I mean, I don't even know Mystique as a character, so I can't say if she's a strong, independent character. But when you come to cosplayer, you could just put on a morph suit. You could do a morph suit or something else, something similar to that. So anyway, after ranting about essentially nude cosplayers at actual Comic Cons as well. Oh my god, we went to a Comic Con recently. There was something called Glamour Zone, and I didn't know what it was. And then we found out, and it was basically just a load of adult stars, stars in, you know, inverted commas. And it basically was people walked in, and then got signed merchandise from these adult stars. But on the outside of it, because it was a big black box, there were basically what you'd classify as not safe work photos, but fully clothed of them. And you were like, this is. One, all the kids are going to see this, but two, mainly two, I bet you they searched really hard for those photos, because I doubt they spent most time. It's just awful. And there's no place in a Comic-Con for that, because it is supposed to be, or at least now, a kid-friendly event, even though it supposedly had its roots in that industry in the first place. But Warwick Davis was there. This was at the Birmingham one, actually, the Glamour Zone, and Warwick Davis. And that was really cool. He was like, he seemed quite genuine and just a really nice guy, which is great to see. So, we're going to start the final assault on Orgulla. And that was it. She just kind of died. It was actually really pathetic. So, yeah, you get 9,000 points and then 11,000 skill points each, which is great. and then one skill upgrade E for killing her. And that's not including the ones that we stole. Don't worry, you've actually stole them. Stole them. So we're going to go into our items now and just take a look. 22 awakenings loaded, and then we use one of them to teach them gravity bomb, and then you're good. We've got 17 skill upgrade E's, which is great. I don't know if I stole them both all the time or whether that was just we had a lot anyway. So anyway, as you've guessed, I just took a quick break to save, because God almighty did I need that break to save. Once you've done that, destroy all these four things and just save, please, dear God. When this falls down, you get out, you can go to the save point. Save. I don't care if you save like five times, just save. Because the next bit is a timed event and you're going to have to escape. Strangely enough, we came in here to blow this shit up, and now we are finally blowing this shit up so we can leave. So just get out of here as quickly as possible. I think you have a 30-minute time limit, but we will see. And yeah, it's going to be fun. So I'll see you, hopefully, in the next episode of Xenosaga, Episode 2, Jenseits von Good und Böse, when we finally destroy this awful, awful, awful dungeon and move on to something hopefully more interesting, where there are green pastures, or at least water. Something that looks... Well, there's water here, but you know what I mean. It's just... I mean, I guess this is the I don't know. I'm just bullshitting. I think that's the reactor that got dropped down there, from what I understand. Not that that makes any sense why you'd have a reactor suspended by things above a pool of water. I guess you just drop it in case the reactor got too hot. It does say almost core unit system, though. But why you'd have that written on your drive... Anyway, who knows? Who cares? I think is the bigger answer. So anyway, I will see you in the next episode. Please join me for that. Hope you've enjoyed this very, very long episode of Xenosaga. And in the next episode, we will blow this shit up and escape and cutscenes and interesting stuff and not stupid bosses. And she just found it. We didn't see her die. She just disappeared. She is so meaningless to this game. Thanks, guys. See you then.